Your Excellency, I thank you for giving me this opportunity. And I want to begin, Mr. President, by commending your leadership of the Senate for allowing the various committees set up to look at issues of this nature to perform their assignment without any interference. Let me cordially commend Senator McCarthy for this highly commendable assignment. I want to say, Mr. President, without any fear of contradiction, that this is one of the best reports, very detailed reports, on a very serious issue. In the first place, Mr. President, I went through this report and I came to a conclusion that it is a report that has succeeded in erasing the misconception, misrepresentation, and falsehood about as to whether $49.8 billion was not remitted. I think it is now clear that the allegation was made perhaps to score some political points. But having said that, Mr. President, I equally want to add that in this report it is equally clear, very clear, crystal clear, that the synergy that is expected within the various departments in the NNPC is not there, was lacking. And I think there is the need for this to be corrected so that there can be proper accountability and transparency in the management of the resources.
Point of order, distinguished Senator Abdul Nenge.
Mr. Senate President, as you call to our order 13, may I move that this Senate do sit beyond 2 o'clock in furtherance to the consideration of this very important report. I so move.
Mr. President, distinguished colleagues, I second the motion that the chamber do sit beyond 2 p.m.
Those in favor of the motion that we do sit beyond 2 p.m. say aye.
Aye.
Against say nay.
Nay.
The ayes have it. Smart.
So, Mr. President, this report is good. And I think all the prayers, quite a number of the prayers, I would like to support. I must say, Mr. President, too, that it is equally clear that there have been some abuses in the way and manner proceeds from oil earnings have been managed. Mr. President, this report is one document that will not die. This report is one document that will outlive this administration. And I will say, Mr. President, that in the Senate, there's always the moment of standing behind your name and all that you believe and all that it stands for. Assignment like this nature, or report like this nature, demands on every one of us to make his position crystal clear on issues that affect the well-being of our people and the progress of our nation. Mr. President, I hold the view that we have seen a lot of exposures, disclosures of some hidden and underarm transactions, which is not in conformity with our constitution. Now, when money is spent and the said amount of money is not appropriated for, it negates the spirit and the content of our constitution. So it is a breach of the constitution for money that are not appropriated for to be spent. And I think our government must rise to the occasion and make sure that those who were involved are brought to book. There is nobody in this country that is above the law, or that should present himself or herself to be above the law. We must make sure that we monitor the implementation of whatever recommendation that we emanate from our deliberation on this report. I want to say, Mr. President, that One very serious issue that have generated a lot of reaction here is as to whether subsidy should be retained or should be expunged. Mr. President, subsidy is maybe the only thing that is left for the poor man in this country. I'm not, of course, not unaware that subsidy is now a conduit pipe where some bourgeois and some terrible Nigerians have been siphoning money at the risk and at the risk of the well-being of other people. So, Mr. President, I am against the removal of subsidy, but being that it is me, I hold a strong view that those who have abused subsidy must be allowed to face the wrath of the law. Today in this country, we have so many cases in court emanating as a result of misappropriation through abuses through the subsidy. But the fact is, the case are lying in court. I think we should appeal to the judiciary to save our country and make sure that all those who are standing trial are not allowed to move around the country free as free citizens when they have killed some thousands of Nigerians directly or indirectly through misappropriation and embezzlement. Mr. President, I will only add that if at all we are going to think about removal of subsidy, then the refineries must be allowed to function. Those who are making it difficult for our refineries to operate are the same people who are involved in the implementation of subsidy. Now, it pays them to allow the reign of subsidy to continue at the expense of the poor people. Mr. President, the bottom line of the problem emanating from implementation of subsidy is nothing else than corruption. Some people are siphoning billions of naira through subsidy. Billions of dollars have been siphoned through subsidy. We must be courageous enough, and I want to ask Mr. President, that this committee should let us know the names of the directors behind the companies that have enjoined this subsidy. We must know the Nigerians who are involved in the importation of crude oil so that we know that these are the people who have not allowed our refineries to operate, to work. Mr. President, I think our government must be courageous enough to confront this problem. Subsidy is the only thing left for the poor man. You remove subsidy, many Nigerians will go quickly to their graves. We must, as a government, be courageous enough to expose those who are making it impossible for the subsidy to get to the roots, to the grassroots people. Subsidy is good in a developing nation, more so a country that prides itself as one of the major producers of oil. The common man must have something out of the system. So subsidy should be retained, but we must equally be courageous enough to bring to book all those who have been siphoning billions of dollars from subsidy. And these are the same people who have made it impossible for the refineries to operate. Mr. President, this is a serious document that we have. And I hope that the Senate will not just pass come up to some resolutions. We must monitor the implementation of this resolution. And we must be courageous enough to ask the executive to implement our resolutions. Because on many occasions, reports are presented here, resolutions are reached, nothing is done about them, and nobody asks questions. We have other reports that we have passed a countable number of resolutions on, and no reaction from the executive. I think, Mr. President, we must ask the executive, if they want us to come here and deliberate and legislate us, then they should implement resolutions. If they don't want us to come, then we sit at homes and allow the executive to run the government. We must rise to the occasion, and we must allow the executive to appreciate that in a democratic government, in a presidential system of government, we have separation of powers. As legislators, we must be allowed to function, just like the executive should have been allowed to function.
Fire.
But for some people,
Amen.
Order, fire.
Well, Mr. President, it's disrupting me, and this is not. There's nothing biased about this. I'm not speaking on the basis of political consideration. I'm speaking as a statesman, and I'm speaking as a patriot. So don't put politics into our discussion.
Fire.
So, Mr. President, well, I rest my case. I rest my case, Mr. President.